Hey everyone, Sam from Professional Music Technology here, and in this video we're covering the basics of how to use the controls on your guitar amplifier. So you've just got your first guitar amplifier and you're ready to plug in and start rocking out, recreating the classic tones that you've heard from your favourite guitar heroes. The only problem is you're a little bit confused as to what exactly each of these little knobs actually does. Now, at first, and especially if you're jamming in a band with your mates where obviously everyone wants to be the loudest, you might be tempted just to crank everything up full. But unfortunately, whilst turning everything up to the max may give you sheer volume, you definitely won't be getting the best tone that your amp can offer. Now, even though the layout of every amplifier will be slightly different, most of them will share quite a few common controls. And once you've got a grasp of what each of these knobs do, you'll soon be dialing in sweet tones quickly and easily from pretty much any amplifier that you plug your guitar into. So let's run through some of the controls that you'll find on a pretty standard guitar amp, and along the way we'll dive a little deeper into what each knob actually does and give you a few tips on how best to use them. So obviously the first thing you're going to see on an amplifier's control panel is an input for your guitar, which hopefully is pretty self-explanatory. And secondly, it's very likely that your amp will have a channel select button, allowing you to switch between clean and overdrive channels. And this gives you two drastically different tones at the touch of a button, or if your amp allows for one, the touch of a foot switch. Now you will find that some amplifiers do have more than two channels, and if you're using a more complex modelling amp, that channel switch may be replaced by an amp model dial, giving you a few more overdrive or distortion options to choose from. But the principle is always pretty much the same, as switching channels or amp models will switch between a cleaner or more overdriven sound. So here's an example of what I mean by clean sound. And here's the kind of tone we're talking about when we're referring to an overdrive, distortion, or dirty channel. So for each of these channels, you'll usually find a volume, and especially on a drive channel, a gain control. The volume controls allow you to balance the output level of each channel, which can be really handy if you want to set the overdrive channel to be louder than the clean channel for heavier sections in songs or for a solo boost. You may also find that along with the separate channel volumes, your amp also has a master volume knob, which will allow you to set the overall output volume of the amplifier without affecting the balance between the clean and the dirty channels. So, what's the difference between gain and volume? Well, in theory, a gain knob controls how much your guitar signal is overdriven, becoming more and more saturated and distorted the more you turn it up. And volume, as its name would suggest, controls how much that signal is amplified, increasing the volume of the sound coming out of the speaker. In practice, however, how some of the subtle tonal characteristics of your amp react to these two controls will also depend on whether you're using a solid state or a valve amplifier. Now internally, amplifiers are usually split into two stages. There's a preamp and then a power amp. The preamp stage, which we usually associate with the gain knob, shapes the kind of initial guitar tone, allowing you to control the desired amount of overdrive or crunch. And then there's the power amp section, which is where the volume controls usually come in. And this determines the output power and volume that you actually hear coming out of the speaker, either lower and quieter for home practice or louder for rehearsals and gigs. Now, most entry-level amps will be solid-state amplifiers, which means that they use transistors to create their sound. I'm not going to get too technical here, but basically the power amp stage of a transistor amp offers a very linear tone, which means that as you increase the volume, the signal stays very clean and doesn't start to distort. This means that in a solid state amp, it's the preamp stage that's doing pretty much all of the work when it comes to shaping the tone that you hear. The tubes in a valve amp, on the other hand, react very differently to the transistors of a solid state amp, with the preamp and power amp sections working much more collaboratively to shape the overall sound of the amp. The gain knob on a tube amp still adjusts how much the signal is overdriven at the preamp stage, but this time the volume controls are equally as important, as just like the preamp valves, the tubes in the amplifier's power amp stage will naturally start to break up the harder they're pushed. And this adds extra colour to the sound, resulting in that lovely, warm, smooth, naturally compressed overdrive sound that you can only really get from a cranked up tube amp. The downside of this though is that valve amps tend to sound better the harder that you push them and the louder they get. So if you start to turn down that master volume, you often lose some of their great tone. So they're not always ideal for low volume practicing. So even though most guitarists prefer the sound of a valve amp, solid state transistor amps are often much more practical as practice amps, as their power amp stage has very little effect on the tone that's created in the preamp. So for example, with a solid state amp, you can have a really high gain, saturated heavy metal distortion tone, but at a very low volume for bedroom practice. Or you can have a very clean tone, which can be turned up quite loud without breaking up into overdrive. All that said though, as I mentioned earlier, from a kind of simplistic beginner's point of view, as a rule of thumb, use the volume controls to balance the levels between the clean and overdrive channels and to set how loud you actually want your amplifier to be, depending on where you're using it. And use the gain control to adjust the amount of crunch, overdrive, or distortion. Just a couple of quick tips for using that gain knob though. Don't go too over the top with it. More gain doesn't automatically result in a heavier sound if that's what you're after. There can come a point where the signal becomes a little too oversaturated and just starts to sound a bit fizzy, where you'll start to lose note clarity and definition, and heavy riffs lose their tightness. So at that point, dial the gain back a bit to clean and tighten up the tone. And don't forget, you'll also need to adjust your use of the gain control depending on your guitar and the pickups that you're using, as humbucker pickups tend to have a stronger output signal than single coils and usually require less gain to push an amp into overdrive. So moving on, next up on our amps control panel are the EQ controls. Now, some amps will have separate EQ sections for both clean and overdrive channels, whilst others will just have a master EQ affecting all of the channels. But what you usually will find are bass, middle and treble knobs. Just like the EQ on your hi-fi or car stereo, bass boosts or cuts the low end frequencies, making the tone boomier or thinner sounding. Middle controls those kind of honky sounding mid-range frequencies, and treble adjusts the top end frequencies for a brighter or duller tone. It's also possible that your amp only has a single tone control, which will be a kind of amalgamation of the bass, middle and treble controls. These single tone knobs will usually adjust the tone of the amp from dark and bassy at one end up to bright and trebly at the other. Another common EQ control on many amplifiers is a presence knob. Now, this one's a little more difficult to describe, but as you turn it up, it kind of emphasizes the upper mid-range and treble frequencies, making the tone sound a little livelier and brighter, and with a bit more kind of zing to it. So as you can hear, these EQ controls can be pretty powerful when shaping the tone coming out of your amp. But just like the gain control that we looked at a moment ago, I definitely wouldn't go too extreme with any of them. For example, a common mistake made by a lot of beginners wanting a high gain, heavy metal distortion tone is to heavily scoop or cut the mid-range frequencies and then boost the treble and the bass. Now, this might sound great in your bedroom, but actually, when you start to play with a band or go into a recording studio, your playing tends to get a little bit lost in the mix or just sound a bit thin and weak, as it's those mid-range frequencies that really help your playing to punch through. What a lot of players will look for when setting up their amp, especially when using a valve amp, is the sweet spot for each of the controls, and this is where the amp really comes alive. Now, this will vary from amp to amp and will also depend on how your amp reacts to your guitar's pickups, single coils being thinner sounding and treblier than mid-range heavy humbuckers. So a technique that a lot of people use to find that sweet spot is to strum the guitar and then slowly adjust each individual knob until you can really hear the point that makes the most noticeable difference to the tone, and that's usually the sweet spot for that particular control. So to give you an idea of the kind of thing that I'm talking about, I've set up a Fender Bassbreaker 007, which is a great sounding little 7-watt valve amp, and plugged into that is a Fender Stratocaster, and I'm using the neck single coil pickup. So with all the controls set to the noon position, it sounds a little bit like this. So the first thing that I want to do is clean that signal up a little bit, so I'm going to turn down the gain. Now let's turn up the master volume. So that should be a little bit cleaner now. So next, let's see if we can find those sweet spots on the EQ. As I mentioned earlier, this is usually the point on the dial where you can hear the control making the most difference to the sound, after which it doesn't seem to have as much of an effect on the tone. So let's start with the bass. So that's with the bass at zero. So I can definitely hear there's a jump around about here, just past 9 o'clock. But I probably want my tone to be a little bit bassier. So I can hear there's another little jump, just at about 1 o'clock. So we'll leave the bass control set there. Next, let's move on to the middle. As you can probably hear, it's not really making much of a difference between 0 and around about 11 o'clock. But there's a definite jump at about 2 o'clock on the dial. So we'll leave the mid-range set there. Finally, let's move on to the treble. Bit too bright for me, that. Again, there seems to be a little bit of a spike at around about 1 o'clock, so we'll leave the treble there. Finally, let's go back to the gain and see if there's anything we can do there. Yeah, just past that 9 o'clock, there seems to be a little bit of a boost in the gain. It's still pretty clean, but it gives the tone a little bit more of an oomph. So let's take a listen. So let's just quickly remind ourselves of what the amp sounded like with the EQ controls set at noon. Here's our tweaked EQ settings. One last time, here's our flat EQ settings. And finally, one more time, here's our EQ settings with the adjustments that we've made. So hopefully you can hear the difference between those EQ settings. You don't have to go too extreme with the tone controls, but some subtle adjustments to find those sweet spots can really help to add some extra punch, depth, and dynamics to your tone. So that's the EQ controls. Finally, let's take a look at any built-in effects that your amp may have. Now, the most common effect found on most guitar amplifiers is a reverb, be it a traditional spring reverb on a boutique valve amp, or the digital reverb found on most solid state amps. And it sounds like this. As you've just heard, reverb kind of emulates the reverberations and reflections that you might get if you were to play your guitar in various different size rooms. And it can be a very versatile effect, adding depth and warmth to your tone, bringing dry, dead sounding playing to life, or you can turn it right up and flood the tone with a kind of dreamy, washy echo effect, making it sound like you're playing in an aircraft hangar. Most reverb controls are very simple to use. The more you turn it up, the more pronounced the effect and the longer the reverberations. As with all of the other controls that we've talked about today, be a little wary of using too much reverb and definitely tailor the amount to the style of music that you're playing. Whilst it's true that adding reverb will often make your playing sound a little bit better and help mask a few mistakes, you will also find that faster, more distorted playing will start to sound very loose and mushy with too much reverb. So if you want your riffs to sound really tight and punchy, definitely dial that reverb back quite a bit or turn it off entirely. Reverb isn't the only effect that you might see on a guitar amplifier though. Nowadays, it's very common to find a lot of affordable solid state modelling amps, such as the Boss Katana, Blackstar ID and Vox Valvetronic models, offering a wide selection of effects that you'd previously only be able to get by purchasing separate effects pedals. The most popular effects found on these amps include modulation effects, such as chorus, phaser and tremolo, which can thicken up your tone or create a more intriguing, interesting sound, and delay and echo effects, which sound great on lead playing. Just like the reverb, they're usually pretty easy to use, with most commonly a single knob adjusting the effects parameters, another knob to control the level or volume of the effect, and quite often a tap tempo button to set the speed of the echo or delay. So obviously, you don't get the same kind of control over the effects as you would do from a dedicated pedal, but they still make a very welcome and handy addition to any amplifier if you want to add an extra dimension to your tone. Thank you. So there we go. I think that's pretty much all of the basics covered. So if you were confused, I do hope that's helped to make a bit more sense of your amplifier's controls. If you did find this video helpful, make sure to give it a thumbs up and hit that subscribe button. And you might also want to go and check out a few more of our beginner's guides videos, which I'll leave linked up in the description below. For more information on any of the gear that you've seen here today, visit pmtonline.co.uk or get down to your local professional music technology store. And as always, don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. That's PMT House of Rock. So thanks for watching. I'll see you again soon.